So I'm going to start, and I'm going to talk for a few minutes. And after each presenter, we'll have a few minutes for questions, and then we can have some other questions at the end. And then I will let each person introduce themselves and tell you a little bit about their projects and about their backgrounds. So we have Dr. Lisa Rosas, Dr. Alicia Salvatore, and everybody knows me, Sandy Winter. And we're going to be talking about conducting research in the real world setting. So part of the research that I do, we know that there are these key health behaviors, three particular health behaviors that have a very big impact on people's health. So these are things like tobacco use, poor diet, and being physically inactive. And these are responsible for four of the major chronic diseases that kill many, many people, responsible for about 50% of global mortality. So we know that we want to change these behaviors because we know that the behaviors and the diseases are connected. So we know that tobacco use is connected to lung cancer, and healthy eating is connected with heart disease, and physical inactivity is connected with obesity. But the problem is that for many years we've been giving people health education, and what we find is that health education is necessary, but it's not sufficient to try and make people's behavior change. So the research that I'm involved in looks at trying to make differences using other technologies or other methods than just telling people to be healthy. So some of the new strategies that we're working on are the background of the projects that I'm going to be talking about. So the one new strategy that we have is advocacy, and you may not all be familiar with that word. Advocacy is when you get together with other people and you form groups to try and persuade people to change environments or behaviors or their way of thinking. So to advocate for change, you're trying to get people to make changes. Then the other issue that we are aware of is that it's something to do with the built environment. So what the built environment is it's all of the man-made features in which we live. So it's the sidewalks and the parks and the quality of the roads and whether or not there are fast food places or farmers markets close to where you live. So it's more about where you live, the features of your environment. And so, for example, if there are no safe places to walk, then people are less likely to be able to walk even if they want to. So in Saudi Arabia, I know that you have parks where families and where women can go and walk. So you can imagine that if there were any towns or villages that didn't have those parks, then even if people wanted to go for a walk, it would be more difficult for them to do that. So some of the research that we do looks at the effect of the built environment on people's ability to behave healthfully. And then the last project I'm going to talk about uses smartphone technology. So using current technology to try and change people's behaviors. So the first project I'm going to talk about is the advocacy project. And what this was we partnered with some seniors who live in a senior housing setting. So this is a little bit different than how things work in Saudi Arabia, because in Saudi Arabia, generally, I think that you have your families to look after you. But here, because of different cultures and a different way of living, sometimes seniors get together and they all live in one building. And so what we did is we negotiated with the seniors who live in these different housing sites in different places, and we tried to get them to form teams. We were very successful, and the teams got together and they made changes for everybody in their environment. So some of the things we did were social things, so they got together and had dinners. We had them conduct surveys, counting people who crossed the street. We had them do cooking classes, and we had them work on a garden. So you can see there's some pictures of the garden before and after. So you can imagine that in order to do this, we had to spend a long time building relationships between the seniors. We had to build relationships with the people who were the housing managers. We had to partner with people at the city government level to try and make some changes that the seniors had identified as being important. And then the seniors themselves formed partnerships. So they got together with some youth groups, groups of young people who were able to help them do some of the projects that they couldn't do by themselves. They got together with different groups of people who were interested in the same things that they were interested in. So the thing about building these relationships is that they can be very powerful, because instead of just having one person who is making a case, you have a whole group of people. But the problem with building relationships is that it takes a long time, and you have to be consistently credible. So if you say you're going to do one thing, you have to actually do it. But this idea of building partnerships, so I can imagine that in Saudi Arabia you might want to build partnerships with, if you're interested in childhood obesity, you might want to partner with the schools. Building relationships with other people takes a lot of time and investment. So now the project that we had to do with the built environment, what this is you can see this lady is holding a 7-inch tablet, and what this project involved was giving people who don't have a lot of experience with technology, we would give them these tablets and tell them to go out into their neighborhood and to take pictures of the features of their built environment, so to take pictures of their sidewalks. You can see here's a picture showing a cracked sidewalk. So for seniors who are in a wheelchair or who don't have very good mobility, they're not able to walk very easily. Things like not having a sidewalk or having a cracked sidewalk might affect them being healthy. And so the idea is that the seniors take pictures of all of these different things, and then they also record their audio about why this picture is important to them. So here there's an example. You can see this is the screen that the people see when they are taking the picture. So it says go for a walk, and then they press a button to take a picture, or they press another button to record their thoughts. And then the idea is that we're going to gather all of this information that we collect from seniors or older people who live all over the Bay Area in lots of different places, and we're going to put it on a map. So here you can see a map that shows the walking route in red. That's where people are walking. And then you can see it shows a picture. So that would represent one of the pictures that the seniors took. And then it has a microphone. So that's the recording that they made about why this was important. So as an example, one of the people that I took on the walk wanted to show me a part of the road where he had been hit by a car. And so he was trying to get the city to put in a stop street or something at that place, and they weren't listening to him. But now he was able to get himself and lots of other people to talk about this particular intersection, and so hopefully the city will now be able to do something. But the take-home point that I have about the practical point about doing research in this project is that when we started doing it, both the seniors and other people told us that elderly people don't know how to work technology, and it will be too difficult for them to do. They won't want to participate in our research projects. They won't be able to figure out how to do the things that we needed them to do. But my point is that actually, with very little training and very little demonstration, we were able to get the seniors to use this technology. They had to scroll, they had to tap, they had to take photographs, they had to record information. There was a survey section that they did. And they were hesitant at first. They were afraid that they wouldn't be able to do it. But once they got the hang of it, which was once they figured out what they needed to do, which happened very quickly, within the first few minutes, they were very, very happy that we had shown them how to use this technology. So they felt empowered because they were part of our research, and they felt that they were doing something that was important, not just for themselves, but for the people in their communities. So my point here is, don't make assumptions about what your population will think about participating in your research, because they might be more interested than you think they will be. So the last study I'm going to talk about is the smartphone technology study. So what this study does is that, again, it's aimed at midlife and older adults, and you see there are three different screens on a mobile phone, and each of these screens provides different information to people, and the idea is that we want them to use this information to become more physically active and to sit less. And so my point about this study is that what we did is we used SurveyMonkey or perhaps something like Google Forms, and we tried to do as much of the data gathering from the participants using this online tool directly, so that the participants, we set the forms up and the participants entered all of their information. So that means that we didn't have to have a researcher gathering in the information, we didn't have to have a researcher entering the information. All the researcher had to do was check that the information was entered correctly. So it's much easier for the participants and it's easier for the researchers. So my caution with this would be, if you do decide that you want to do online data gathering, you would have to test it first. So get some of the your family members or some of your students or some of the students' parents to test the forms and make sure that, ask people, when you completed this form, was anything unclear? Was there anything that you didn't understand? Or was there any information that you wanted to give me that you felt I didn't ask in the form? And if you use maybe 10 pilot tests, test the form with about 10 different people, you'll soon know whether or not the form is giving you the information that you want. So that would be my last take-home point, is to use online data gathering tools because it just is more efficient and easier. So that, I think, is all that I have. So before I move to the next person, I'm going to see if I can figure out if anybody has any questions. So does anybody have any questions that they want to ask? I'm going to let her introduce herself.
So I move the slide. Mm-hmm. So good night, everyone, or good morning here from California. My name is Lisa Rosas. I'm an epidemiologist here at the Stanford Prevention Research Center. And Sandy asked me to talk with you all about some practical research strategies that we've learned as a result of our research here. The points that I'm going to share with you today mainly come from research we've conducted around childhood obesity and adult obesity, both observational research as well as intervention research. As I said, I'm an epidemiologist, but I have a background in community work and health education, so both of those points of view will come across in these points that I'm going to share with you. And I can see the questions now, so feel free to ask questions as we go along. You don't have to wait until the end. So I'm going to share these four points: understanding your population, using a community-based approach, building flexible interventions, and directly addressing community concerns. First point is around understanding your population. So before you begin any intervention research, it's really important to get a very detailed and in-depth understanding of the population that you're going to be working with. So first, that means identifying the subpopulations that are at highest risk for the health outcome or health condition that you're interested in studying or intervening upon. So this could be anything from consumption of fruits and vegetables as a health behavior, or it could be obesity, or it could be cardiovascular disease. But understanding who those folks are in your community that are at highest risk for those endpoints is really important. So how do you do that? There's a lot of different ways you can go about doing it, and you can do it really with very little resources at the beginning. The idea is just to get started. So you can use secondary analyses of existing data that might be at your disposal, either through your school, through demographic health surveys at both at the country level even. You can, of course, conduct your own population-based surveys. And I think Sandy mentioned one way of doing that through SurveyMonkey or Google Forms. There's ways of doing it that are at very low cost. You can do clinic-based surveys if you're a physician or you work in a clinic. You can survey folks that come into your clinic, understanding that certain people are more likely to come into health centers or clinics than others. You can do a review of medical records. Depending on whether you have paper or electronic records at your disposal, the approach can be different, but both can be done. And then, like I said, any sort of online data collection that's now beginning to be more and more at our disposal can be one way to gather information on who are those at highest risk in your community. So as part of this step of understanding your population, you want to know who these folks are, but you also really want to describe them. Now, this is where you can use both quantitative and qualitative methods. So you can do this through surveys and medical record reviews and population-based methods, but you can also do this through qualitative methods like focus groups. So in general, you really want to know the demographics of the populations that you are going to design these interventions or these studies for. Their gender, simple things, gender, age, marital status, their occupation, where they live. you also really want to understand some of the psychosocial issues. So what do I mean by psychosocial? These are issues such as culture or social class. That can describe your population. And then you also want to understand some of the comorbidities. So in our study that we're working with obese adults, depression is one of the most common comorbidities, as is diabetes that you might imagine. So it would not behoove us to design an intervention that didn't address these significant comorbidities. Because our intervention would not be successful. So it's really important for us to understand what are these other health issues that the population is facing. So really the take-home message here of understanding your population is that it's crucial for designing effective interventions. You wouldn't want to design an intervention thinking all your participants were middle-aged married men when actually you had a diverse population that included women or adolescents or something like that. Okay, so the second point that I want to talk about today is about using a community-based approach. So in our experience designing interventions that address issues like diet and physical activity, obesity, cardiovascular disease, it's been very important to partner with community organizations to identify community leaders and to implement those interventions in collaboration with those community partners and community leaders. So I want to talk a little bit more about each of these three points under a community-based approach. So partnering with community organizations, so these could be civil organizations, non-governmental organizations, or just community-based organizations where you're working. But the idea here is to treat them as an equal partner in your research endeavor. So recognizing that they bring an expertise to the table that you as a researcher or a medical professional don't have. While you may have really in-depth understanding of what diabetes is or the clinical consequences of obesity, what sometimes we have to recognize as researchers is that we might not understand how the community views obesity or how the community views their dietary intake. In fact, they probably don't call it dietary intake, they probably call it eating. but we really need to bring in those organizations and involve them in every step of the research, from the conception of the project all the way till the analysis of the findings. So I can't emphasize that enough, it's a really important point. So as part of that work, identifying community leaders, these are really the folks who are the experts within the organizations that you're working with. These are kind of like the folks who have a PhD in your community. They know what's going on, and they know how to effectively complete research and do it in a way that the community is going to be responsive to. So a good way to identify community leaders is through focus groups and key informant interviews. This is a way you can find out who those folks are and get to know them and involve them. And so the main point here is just involving the community organizations and the community leaders from the design to the implementation, all the way through the analysis of the project. So following along, another aspect of using a community-based approach includes hiring and training research staff from within the community you're working. So no research project can be completed by one person, usually, especially intervention research. You need to train and hire people who are going to help you carry out your research, people who are going to conduct surveys, people who are going to do health education, whatever the type of research that you're going to do. So the best way to conduct effective intervention research is to work within the resources of the community. So hiring and training research staff has several benefits. That means you'll hire research staff who already understand the population that you're working with. It also means that you'll be giving back to the community by training folks who are now experts in the area that you're doing research. And those folks will always be there in that community, whether your research project continues or ends. Consider using community health workers. So community health workers, are also called lay health promoters, are folks that you can train in the health area that you're working, and they can work directly with the participants in your study with a point of view of where they're coming from. So the idea of a community health worker is to take the clinical information that you want to deliver to your participants and help the community health worker to deliver it to your population with an understanding of where that population is coming from and the challenges and barriers that they may be confronting. And then finally, working within existing healthcare or social services to improve sustainability. So oftentimes in the past, I think researchers have created new clinics or created new organizations in order to complete their research. But we found that that's not sustainable, and that when the research is over, those resources leave the community. So a better way to approach this is to improve or work with existing health clinics or social services in the community so that they continue when your research project is ended. Ideally, if the intervention you've worked on is successful and is proved to be efficacious, then those programs could be adopted by those existing healthcare services and continue long after you've left. So I think I've mentioned some of the benefits as we've gone through, but just to reiterate, using a community-based approach really meets community needs. That means that instead of doing exactly what we think needs to be done, it meets the community in what they need and what they may be looking for. And that makes it more sustainable because they're more likely to continue with a project that they see as necessary or that they can incorporate into their daily lives. And overall, a community-based approach is just shown to be more effective. But I don't want to say that it's easy. I want to mention just a few challenges that a community-based approach can bring. So it can add extra time and complexity. Working with community-based organizations and community leaders and community health workers can add extra complexity to a project that you may not be familiar with. And then community organizations and leaders can face their own resource challenges. They may be understaffed or underfunded, and that can create tensions and problems as well. Okay, so the third point is to build flexible interventions. So in one of our studies around a case management approach to obesity management, one of the benefits of this study has been that we've been able to adapt the intervention based on language or gender or where the people live or any other factors that may vary among your population we've been able to adapt this intervention to several different contexts. So instead of creating an entirely new intervention every time for a new population, we take a base intervention that we can then adapt and change for each different context. Okay, my final point is to directly address community concerns. And this is at the outset of the research, as well as throughout the research process. So community members and participants may often be skeptical of the research that we're doing. They may not understand the larger purpose of the research or have your same perspective. And oftentimes we're asking participants, excuse me, to do quite a bit in our research projects, attend different health education sessions, come to the clinic various times, likely more often than they would without a research project. And it's important for us to understand how they view that and to address it directly. So that means from the outset understanding what those concerns are, and that means during the informed consent process and throughout the research, providing opportunities for participants where you can address those concerns. And again, that includes improving existing health services rather than creating new ones, and that has to do with the sustainability issue that I mentioned before. And this also means providing compensation for research participation when appropriate. Here in the United States, it's common to give gift cards or coupons to participants in exchange for their participation in our research projects. I've worked in other countries where direct compensation, such as a gift card, is not appropriate, but providing some sort of compensation for research participation when it is appropriate can be very valuable. In randomized control trials, minimizing the size of control groups where it's statistically appropriate can go a long way to addressing community concerns about research. It's very difficult for community organizations and participants to understand the purpose of a control group, especially given all of the effort that goes into conducting an intervention research study. So thinking about ways that you can minimize the size of the control group but still be statistically efficient is a great idea. And finally, considering a delayed intervention for the control group is another way to give back to the community more than we're taking away. So having the control group have no intervention for the period of time that the active intervention groups experience the intervention, but then providing some intervention activities to those control group participants at the conclusion of the research so that everybody receives something. And that concludes my comments.
Brianna McLean. I'm a pediatric obesity researcher, and most of my research focuses on developing interventions for overweight children and their families. I'm actually going to build on what Dr. Lisa Goldman-Rosas was talking about, and specifically she was talking about improving existing health services rather than creating new ones. And so my goal for today is to show how we have used research to enhance an evidence-based program already in existence at our hospital, and that's the Packard Pediatric Weight Control Program. So what is the Packard Pediatric Weight Control Program? It is a family-based group behavioral and educational program that promotes lifelong healthy eating and exercise habits for overweight children and their families. And it's part of our Center for Healthy Weight. And it's a 6-month weight control program for children and families. The class is taught in a group setting and focuses on lifestyle changes. And physicians can refer, or patients and families can self-refer themselves into this program. During the weight management program, groups of 12 families meet together every week for 6 months. families are encouraged to attend each of the 25 sessions, and throughout the program, participants and their families learn to identify and avoid high-calorie, low-nutrient foods, develop better exercise habits, reduce sedentary behaviors, such as television watching, and follow a healthy, balanced diet to maintain a healthy weight over the long term. How do we do this? Well, the program is made up of four phases. In the first phase, the program helps create a balanced diet to limit unhealthy food, and it's based on Dr. Lynn Epstein's traffic light diet. And a traffic light diet means red. There's red foods, which means stop and think, yellow foods that mean proceed with caution, and green foods that mean go. And it's been demonstrated to be the best long-term results in the literature for weight loss and 10-year weight maintenance in children and adolescents. The children and parents are also encouraged to record everything they eat and drink in a food journal during the program. And parents are then asked to set weekly goals to limit the number of unhealthy foods they eat. In the second phase of the program, we focus on exercise habits and how families can incorporate more physical activity into their daily lives using a point system. So for example, 30 minutes of walking is equal to 1 point, and there are a set amount of points a child and their parents are supposed to attain each day or each week. And in the third phase, every 6 to 7 weeks, each family meets individually with a behavioral coach for 30 minutes to discuss progress as well as support for any specific obstacles or concerns. And finally, the maintenance phase of the program helps families practice and reinforce these healthy behaviors. And it helps in dealing with difficult situations. So for the last 10 sessions, we alternate between maintenance and physical activity sessions. And finally, there's a group session format. So the way the group sessions are formatted is for the first 30 minutes, we actually engage in measurement and feedback, where we have weekly weight measurement, monthly height measurement, and we review the food and exercise journal. Then for the next 30 minutes, the children and parents separate to discuss specific child and parent experiences. And we problem solve in that setting. And then finally, for the last 30 minutes, everyone comes together to identify obstacles and develop solutions to reach goals. The benefit of the Packard Pediatric Weight Control Program is that, and the way it's currently set up, is that not only is it an evidence-based program that can be a continuously offered resource at the hospital to help children achieve and maintain a healthy weight, we can also use it as a research program. And as a research program, we can test additional program components, such as adding a home advisor or changing the format of the current structure to assess if there, by adding this additional component, there are differences in weight loss or weight maintenance over time. And we can also assess cost effectiveness. The next slide. I'm going to outline how we have actually incorporated research into the Packard Pediatric Program. So in our current study, we were really interested in knowing if adding a home advisor to the current program resulted in more clinically significant weight loss or weight maintenance at 6 months and at 18 months. And we wanted to see not only a home advisor, but incorporating environmental changes such as smaller dishware or television turnoff device was going to result in these changes. So I'm going to show you how we did that using our standard program. So for recruitment, we actually engaged in standard program recruitment. So therefore, physicians referred children and their families into the program, and when children and families heard about the program, they self-referred themselves. And then we had a screening and consent. For screening and consent, there is a standard program screening. However, after they were screened into the program, the program staff then sent them to a research staff member to make sure that they were eligible for the research program. So they had to be greater than the 95th percentile and make sure that there was no comorbidities that were going to affect the study. Then we conducted a baseline visit that was collected by research staff. So before they could be randomized into the study, there was a weekend in which all of the people that were in the program had to come for height, weight measurements, and standard data collection that we needed. Finally, after the baseline data collection and we made sure that we had dietary records and physical activity measurement, the participants were randomized either into the standard program versus the standard program plus this additional component. Therefore, as Dr. Lisa Goldman-Rosas was saying, even the control group has a treatment that has been proven to be effective. Finally, we conduct the intervention, and we utilize the program staff for the standard program, but we add a research staff for the research component. So for the home advisors, that was research staff because we didn't want to contaminate the control program. We wanted the standard program to proceed as is and not actually know too much about what we were doing in the intervention because we were afraid that they might change what they were doing, what they were already doing. And then finally, we followed up with data collection at 6 months and 18 months, and we're currently analyzing the data. So I guess in conclusion, my take-home point is that research can be used to enhance any evidence-based program already in existence, and simply adding a research arm to a current program can be used to test the effectiveness of additional components. Do you have any questions? Let me explain the reason I think why we did it is that a lot of weight loss programs focus specifically on behavior change and motivation and psychosocial avenues to change behavior, and we were really curious about if we add this environmental component, if we go into the homes and we make these changes, that if just these simple environmental changes, such as smaller dishware or such as a television turn-off device that limits the amount of time a child watches television, and I'll specifically go into that in a moment or two, if that, without more motivation or psychosocial pushing, can result in more clinically significant weight loss. And the reason why we chose a television turn-off device and plates is that there is a researcher named Brian Wansick that showed that perhaps simply reducing plate size can change eating habits over time. So we use a television turn-off device, and it's called the Bob. And the Bob is connected to a television, and a child has to insert a code to watch TV. And it actually shuts the TV off for certain periods of time that the parent has set. So it budgets the amount of time. So perhaps a parent can say, I only want my child to watch 7 hours of TV a week. And when they run out, they're done watching TV for the week, versus it acts as a parent to the television versus a parent always having to telling the child to turn the TV off. And it's quantitative, so it knows versus a child can't say, I didn't watch TV this or then, because the Bob knows. We use smaller plates that are 9 inches rather than in America our typical plate size is 11 inches. And just we were hoping that that's a one way of reducing portion size without consciously thinking about reducing portion size. So those are some avenues that we use because there's not necessarily any intervention that has tested that. And so we wanted to just add this one component to our current studies to see maybe this does result in a greater effect on weight loss than our standard program.
So I know that when I was in that part of the office where Ariana is and her team are, there are boxes in that office of people's plates,
yes,
and dishes, because they actually go into the people's homes with their permission and they take out all of the plates that people have in their homes and they give them other plate sizes for the duration of their study. So that is not something that you would typically think about doing when you sign up for a research project. But I just want to use that as an illustration of how, if you have a cool idea that you think is going to make a difference, that you can try it in perhaps a small setting. So how many people did you have in that plate study, do you know?
So currently we have 120 people. Our goal is to get 120 people in our plate study, but it started off as a pilot study with just, we wanted to see if it was even doable. So we did a pilot study of 5 families, and we've actually learned a lot from our pilot studies. So in our pilot study of 5 families, we went in and we asked if this was realistic, and surprisingly, as invasive as it may seem of taking plates, we went in and we gave them, as long as the plates were just as nice or approximately just as nice as the plates that they were had, that they had, they were very open to it. But don't get me wrong, there was a lot of piloting. So there was a point where a plate was too small. And so we're conducting another pilot study right now, figuring out what is too small and what is the perfect size plate, because you can't go in and take an 11-inch plate and give them a salad plate and expect them to be okay. So we came to the conclusion that 9 inches was a good size plate because it still looked the size of a normal plate, but it was smaller on average than everyone's plates. And so it's been an interesting lesson of not just going in and taking everything, but asking and to some extent conducting focus groups of what is a good plate size and what can we do. And that's the importance of piloting before conducting a large study, is figuring out, are they open to it? Yes. Okay, they are open to us taking their plates. But more importantly, how can I conduct my intervention, but at the same time make our study participants satisfied without them? We do want them to come back and such.
So this is a very important point that we've raised numerous times before, is this idea of pilot testing small numbers just to see if it works. Can you do the thing that you're thinking about doing? If you're gathering data, are your forms correctly done? If you're doing an intervention, are people okay with you coming into their homes to take their plates? How are you going to store it? How long are you going to do the study for? So this idea of pilot testing with projects is really important. Does anybody else have any questions for Dr. McLean?
Okay.
Okay, hello everyone. I hope you're all still awake. I know it's very late for you all over in Saudi Arabia. My name is Alicia Salvatore, and I am, my background is in public health, and I'm a behavioral scientist. So the bulk of my research, like many other people here at the Prevention Research Center, is on both research that is intervention research, so developing programs to change behavior and improve health conditions, but also a lot of my work is participatory research, so community-based participatory research, which is an intensive form of participation with communities and community-based organizations throughout the research process. So you've heard a number of things and about a number of partnerships throughout everyone's presentations today. And I would just, since I'm the concluding speaker, I'd like to just bring us back to some statistics that I think are very helpful for reminding us why it's important to do research that's based in the real world. And so in terms of your work in, I understand that the majority of you are in the field of medicine, but in public health and psychology and medicine, we're all working in very applied fields. So the implications of the research that we do, even though we might bite off very small pieces to actually study or include in our studies, are the implications are things that we'd like to scale up and integrate either into clinical practice to improve the outcomes of clinical practice, or to integrate into public health practice so that we can improve ultimately the conditions in which people can be healthy, and also making people healthier when they get sick. So just to start, I'm not on a a fairly depressing note is that despite all of the resources and research into practices not so good, in terms of the interventions, just thinking globally about public health interventions and medical interventions, the most successful interventions rarely reach 1% of the target audience, which means they're, you know, you might have a tightly controlled research study that's done that has very good outcomes, but the translation of that program into general practice up at scale, at large scale, is very, very small. And then the time lag for turning just a small percentage of research, clinical research, into clinical application takes about 2 decades. So we're really missing the mark here when we think about the time lag. There's a very large gap between research and practice across all of these fields. So in my piece of the presentation, I'm going to focus on one study that has been quite intensive that I'll introduce in a second. But I'd like to point out the ways that really focusing on partnerships, approaches, and action-oriented approaches to research can help us bridge the gap that exists between research and practice. So I've just changed the slide. The actual working conditions of the workers and compare those with the working conditions that were reported by the survey participants, because as many of you probably well know, one of the criticisms about doing survey research is there isn't often a validated measure that can tell you the extent which people are telling the truth, or that their reports might be skewed or changed by other issues. Sorry. So the first kind of take-home point and focus that I'd like to share with you builds upon some of the points that that some of the other speakers have talked about, which is the real importance in training and engaging and community-based organizations and non-governmental organizations as partners in research. What I'd like to emphasize about our study was the very intensive involvement and training of the community that was really researched itself, so meaning the Chinese restaurant workers themselves. We established a restaurant worker leadership group as a core group of leaders for our study at the onset of the project. And we also trained another 21 community members later on as surveyors for the project, which were different from this group. The restaurant worker leadership group required a very intensive investment in training, because these were people who worked as restaurant workers and had never probably participated in research before, let alone been involved with tasks such as designing a survey, helping us come up with consent forms for the study that would make sense to this population, participating in training other community members in how to administer a survey, and even doing things like looking at tables of data and trying to make sense of the issues that were coming out of, and helping us figure out whether the reports we were getting from our survey participants made sense and reflected the reality of their experiences or not. So one of the things that were really important, so this, as I mentioned, required a lot of investment. And it required a financial investment in terms of we wanted to be able to pay people for their time, which means writing this in upfront in the grant. The other thing it involved was we were working with many different languages and making sure that things, we had money and time to take things that were created by researchers like me in English. Unfortunately, I don't speak any of the languages of this community, and I'm not able to write in Chinese. So being able to have the resources also to translate that those material and putting that in the timeline. The training, they met weekly at least for training to help contextualize the context of the research studies. So it wasn't just a research study we're asking them to participate in, but also helping them to constantly make the connections between how this research could really benefit their community and benefit them. And the other thing that it really took was also developing them not just as co-researchers, but actually leaders in the community. Many of these people were very, very anxious in the beginning, and we wanted to call them a leadership group, and they were actually telling us, no, please don't use the word leader, I'm not a leader. So it involved a lot of different activities in terms of developing these men's and women's ability to stand up and to talk to others, and by the end of the study, present data in the community and do many very sophisticated things that were beyond the scope of their usual training and experience. The community restaurant worker leadership group was actively involved, as I mentioned, throughout the process. So they helped to identify questions for the survey. We used standardized and validated measures of working conditions and health used by many other surveys for the purposes of the research and to make comparisons. We also wanted to give the community themselves the opportunity to identify questions that they had for the survey. They also, so things that they came up with were things like whether people who were not smokers were actually called in sooner from breaks than other people, and things that they had seen that we would not think of at all but could be important for potential interventions in the future. For our restaurant observations, restaurants are constantly opening and closing in Chinatown, so the one of the things, and there's a picture at the top here, they helped us to map the locations of the restaurants and identify additional risks that were part of their working experience in the restaurants that we integrated into our checklist measure that we use for restaurant observations. They helped us pre-test the study instruments. As I mentioned, they helped us recruit and train other survey workers, and they were actively involved in the collection of the survey data in addition to the recruitment. And I just want to mention that Chinatown is a relatively small neighborhood in which there are very few secrets. Many people are related to the employers. There's a lot of fear in terms of, you know, there being retaliation of employers hearing that someone had participated in firing them from their position. So this took incredible trust. And one of the ways that we ensured that trust is to have people from the community that were actually trusted leaders, not just people from the community, because there are many people in the community that aren't trusted, to actually show that this research study was something that was important. And they also did help us to interpret the research findings, and they did reality checks with the community when some of the statistics and findings didn't look quite right, where people might have answered differently because of fear or other reasons. So I want to just say that investing in training especially of community members themselves can help not only enhance research outcomes like increasing in participation and having more culturally relevant and intelligible survey and research tools, but can actually, as other people have mentioned, really contribute to building long-term leadership in the community that has a lot of other beneficial aspects for increasing the community's health and also allowing there to be more of a continuum between research and action and change. The next point that I'd like to stress about this study and share with you is the importance of dissemination. And I don't know if that's a term, I think many of you probably are familiar with this term, but in case you're not, dissemination just simply means
The sharing of results, or, you know, if you have an intervention, if you disseminate the intervention, that means that you share the intervention so it can be used by other people. So the dissemination that I'm talking about here is sharing and planning for how you're going to share research results early on, and thinking about multiple methods of sharing results. Of course, it's very important for all of our careers to publish results in academic journals or medical journals, to share our results with colleagues at conferences, and to share our results with students so that they may learn. But it's very important to also plan to make the connection again between research and the real world by sharing the results with the people themselves who have been researched, and also the larger community. And this often means sharing results in lots of venues and manners that might be very beyond the training that we ourselves have as researchers. So this is where the expertise of community partners and the knowledge of community partners can be very, very helpful. So some of the ways beyond the academic journal, I just put one journal where we published a paper in the American Journal of Industrial Medicine. We also published results in a Chinese newspaper, which is read by the community. And we also planned, we also had worker teas, in which our members of the community-based organization, also the restaurant leadership group leaders, shared results and experiences of the study with people in the community. And this helps to raise awareness of the issue itself, and to prime the community for changes, and to get behind changes that might be necessary to change some of the things that you find in your research. On the far right, I'm sorry, it's so small you can't read, but it's a letter from our community partner, the San Francisco Department of Public Health, and it's a letter sharing some of the results with some of the other agencies that are mandated with enforcement of working conditions in restaurants. This is to the Department of Industrial Relations, which is actually one of the governmental and state bodies that's mandated with actually making changes. And so this letter is both briefing them on some of the findings that we found in terms of some of the laws that were not being followed and the need for better enforcement, and also a request for setting up a meeting where the partners from the health department were setting up meetings to try to figure out better ways to collaborate and to make some policy changes in order to have better enforcement and address these issues. The other thing that was very key and different about this study than many others is while we created separate research reports, one authored by me and a colleague is presenting the survey findings, and a report authored by the health department for reporting the observational findings, we had applied early on for another grant from a foundation, a local foundation, to make sure that we could fund and disseminate the study results in lots of different ways. So we got actually a quite substantial grant from a funder that is very interested in the translation of results into action. And this enabled us, the community partner, the Chinese Progressive Association, created their own report, which included the survey findings from the restaurant observation findings, but also contextualize these issues in the larger kind of economic and social framework of the community. And so the way that they presented these results were slightly different, but very important for priming the environment for policy change. And as part of this report, the focus was not only on just presenting the findings, actually came up with key recommendations, and they presented a draft Bill of Worker Rights that they then were planning on having some action around. They launched this report in a very public press event that was attended by several hundred people, including members of the city government, the Board of Supervisors in the city of San Francisco, which is the city government in San Francisco. And in this, they launched the report as well as the recommendations for change. And this event, the community partner is very, very savvy. They know how to do media events, and they know how to make change and make noise and get the word out in ways that we don't necessarily have training to do in the research world. And as part of this, what you see is the event itself, and some of these pictures are maybe not so clear, but the event is being covered by four major TV stations. And it was covered by the newspaper in San Francisco. And the results are being presented from the survey by the members of the restaurant leadership group. And this is just a screenshot of, we got a front page article in the San Francisco Chronicle, which was one of the first articles in a long time that was talking about the problems of workers' working conditions and health. So, the point I'd like to make in this take-home point is not just to share these results because it's good to do so and because it's ethical, but because sharing results beyond the traditional academic channels really, pardon this is a colloquialism, but I hope it makes sense, it sets the stage, which means it you know, gets all the pieces in place for the action that we really hope to have. We really hope that our research is going to lead to action, that's going to lead to and change and improvements, and the community is going to feel like their investment in the research was for something and it wasn't just an exercise. So the last part is actually in this participatory research approach that which was the orientation for our Chinatown study, is that action is a focus on action and the commitment for researchers to stick around and help to do things like we did, like write additional grants to fund the action piece, is really considered part of the research process itself. You're in the process through the finish, and this is really, again, responding to some of the statistics that I presented in the beginning, that we really have a very poor track record of making change, and that also the communities themselves are calling for, you know, many communities can tell stories, most communities, especially underserved communities, of research projects coming through and measuring them and asking them questions and then leaving and them never feeling like they're benefiting at all from any of this. So I'd like to tell you a nice story of how in the Chinatown study, our research actually did lead to change. So one of the major study issues that was uncovered by our survey, there were many issues, as you can imagine, because this is a very poor working population, working in very hard conditions. But one of the major issues was not a traditional health issue, as we often study. We think of it as more of an economic issue or a human rights issue. But the issue is that the workers were being cheated out of their wages in many different forms. And so we refer to this as wage theft. So wage theft could be that you're not being paid minimum wage. It could be that you're cheated out of your legally mandated breaks. It could be that you're, in the city of San Francisco, even very low-wage restaurant workers have a right to sick leave. It could be that you are not given your sick leave. It could be that you are forced to work overtime and that you're not paid overtime. So we found kind of gross problems in all of these areas. So one of the things, so shortly after the launch and press event from our survey findings, the community-based organization and the health department got together with the city officials, and they drafted, they wanted policy change. They wanted, even though all of these things were already policies on the books, they wanted more strict and more efficient legislation and ordinances or policies on the books to enable them to to better address the issue of wage theft and to have workers have an ability to be able to go after their lost wages. And clearly, although this is not a traditional health issue, as we think of health issues in terms of obesity or exercise, not having enough money and not being paid your wages has huge implications for pretty much any life, social, or health issue there is. If you're not able to feed your family, clearly it's a very stressful situation. We all like to get our paychecks, so I don't think I need to tell you about how bad it is not to be paid. So the community partner drafted this legislation, and then for a period of just about a year, they formed an alliance with other similar organizations whose workers were very similar to the workers in our study, low-wage, largely immigrant workers, although they weren't necessarily workers who were part of our study. But they formed an alliance, and they had press events and community education events for about a year, trying to raise awareness and to get a consensus and support from the government and also from the people of San Francisco to support this new ordinance. And this is just some pictures from one of the press events on the City Hall of San Francisco. So the good news is that in less than a year, you probably don't remember the date, but we launched our comprehensive report on the 17th of September in 2010, and on the 16th of September in 2011, the mayor signed into law an ordinance, which is the first city wage theft prevention ordinance in the United States. This was unanimously passed by the city supervisors and then signed into law by the mayor. And while obviously this effort was not just the research that made this happen, the research was an integral part of this. And as a testament to this, I'd just like to share with you a quote. This is Eric Marr, who's one of the members of the city government board of supervisors. And he said when he introduced this legislation, he was proud to introduce the legislation that was drawn from action-based research and bottom-up grassroots organizing that would strengthen the labor laws in San Francisco and workers a meaningful voice in stopping wage theft in the city. So the take-home point for this is that real partnerships with organizations and organizations that have capacity and skills, as Lisa and others had pointed out, that are very different than the skills that researchers bring to the table, that partnerships with them can really lead to change. And that's really because of focusing on topics that are of importance to the community, long-term investment in spending time and resources in developing all of our capacities, not just the capacity of community to work with researchers, but the capacity of researchers to work in communities that are very different from their own. And it helps us not only to make change, but to increase the potential for these changes to be sustainable and to make real improvements in the lives of people in the real world over time. So thank you.
So I don't know if anybody has any questions for Alicia.